Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. My name is Stephen Frank. I'm the director of the Bloodless program at Johns Hopkins. And I'm so glad everybody could be here today to help us celebrate our two-year anniversary of being open as the Center for Bloodless Medicine and Surgery. We have six speakers in the lineup, including myself, and we have two of those six speakers are special guests, I call them, and I'll be introducing them in a few minutes. I didn't know what to call this seminar, so it was a combination of education and celebration, to be honest. Education to tell everybody here about how bloodless medicine works. So we have some of the experts in the field here to tell you what we do. And also a celebration of our two-year opening, and I'm going to show you what we've done in the last 2 years. So somebody asked me after our last open house, why did you start this program? And I thought that was a good question. And the short answer is that my chairman of my department asked me to. But after we had just a handful of patients, I recognized right away that Jehovah's Witness patients were some of the friendliest, most appreciative, and nicest patients that you could take care of. For example, we did a brain tumor surgery on a patient about a year ago. And afterwards, I go to talk to the family in the family lounge after the surgery, and five family members came up to me and hugged me, and some of them kissed me. Okay, so I'm an anesthesiologist. I'm not used to that. And it just blew me away how grateful and how appreciative the family members and the patients are when you can do things that other hospitals can't do. So with that introduction, I'm going to tell you how it works. And how it really works is the people that we have in our program. And I'm going to introduce seven people, including myself. And I'm going to tell you who's speaking today. So to the right side of me is Linda Reesar, and she's here today. She's our hematology consultant. She's an associate professor. She's originally from Wisconsin, but she trained at Hopkins in pediatrics and hematology and oncology. So she's a multi-specialist, and she helps us with our anemic patients, and she'll be giving a talk on anemia. To the right is Liza Wick. She's a general surgeon that specializes in every type of surgery from the chest to the pelvis. So she's an expert in colorectal surgery, and she's on our team, and she's not here today. She's the only one that's not here today. Then we have Liz Dacu, who is our nurse coordinator. She's been with us since the beginning, and Liz will be speaking on what happens when you call in and ask about bloodless surgery. Andy Pippa is here. He's our administrative coordinator. He and Joan, as you might guess, are married, and Joan is our communications director. So Andy and Joan work closely, and Joan is responsible for setting up the seminar today, and I think she did a wonderful job. If you want to give her a hand. So this is our newest member of our team. Isha's been with us for 2 months. I didn't have a professional picture of her, so I just grabbed whatever I could off the internet. I think this is off Facebook. So Isha was working over on Meyer 9, or Meyer 7, Meyer 7, and Andy found out about her and said, do you know there's a Jehovah's Witness who's a nurse who works on Meyer 7, and she's wonderful. And I said, well, we got to get her on our team. So we figured out how to steal her away from Meyer 7, and her supervisor was not happy about that. So Isha's been with us for 2 months, and she won't be speaking today, but I'd like to introduce her, if she could raise her hand. So I showed this slide a year ago, and I was amazed that after 1 year of of operation that we had 154 Hopkins physicians that had taken care of our patients without blood transfusion. And now Andy and I just updated this slide. I didn't have the updated version, but we can add 40 more Hopkins doctors, 40. So we're up to about 200 Hopkins physicians that have taken care of patients that agreed to provide care without transfusion. And you might see down here, anesthesiology, 45 physicians. So in my department in anesthesia, we had so many doctors that have taken care of witness patients that there are too many to list on this slide. The special guests today that we have, first, Misop Han is here. He's an associate professor of urology, and he trained at Hopkins, went to med school at Hopkins, and he's climbed the ranks academically, and he's now one of the experts in the country when it comes to minimally invasive prostate and bladder and urology surgery. So he's going to give a talk on minimally invasive surgery. And we have the highlight of the afternoon, if you will, is going to be Tammy Martin Worley, and she's sitting right here in the second row in the blue polo shirt. There she is. I call her one of our star patients because about 6 months ago, Tammy had a very, very difficult open heart surgery that we did without blood transfusion after she was refused or turned down at one of the other top three medical centers in the country. And now she's here today. She's back at work, and she came with her mother and father. And we're going to hear her story from her herself. How we operate. So one of the unique things about our program that I don't think any other bloodless program in the country can offer is we are always available. That's 24/7 and 365. We have a pager number. It's even listed on our website. We were afraid to put it out there at first because we thought the pager would ring constantly. But it turns out that most people respect the fact that, you know, unless it's a dire emergency, that things can usually wait till the morning. And either Andy or Isha or myself carry this pager. You can find it by Googling Hopkins Bloodless. And we are truly, I think, one of the only programs in the country that has someone available to speak to 24/7. So at the rate we're enrolling patients now, we're getting 400 patients a year, so almost one new inpatient every day. These are inpatients. Actually, more than one new inpatient every day. And outpatients, 1,300 outpatients annually. And if you add that up, that's 1,700 patients per year that we're taking care of. And we are twofold ahead of where we predicted we would be at the two-year mark. So that's why we're celebrating 2 years, because we're doing really well. I want to mention three challenging cases that are on our website if you want to see the details. And these are surgical cases that few, if any, bloodless programs in the country would be able to perform. And Tammy is one of the three cases. I'll show her third. First of all, we have a case on our website of a fenestrated endovascular aortic stent graft. So it turns out there's only 13 hospitals in the country that can do this procedure because it's new. And we had a lady come in on a Sunday night with a rupturing aortic aneurysm. It's one of the worst problems you can have. It's associated with a high mortality. And she came in on Sunday night. One of our vascular surgeons is credentialed to do this new procedure. What makes it new is it has holes for the renal arteries, okay, like windows. That's the fenestrations. And other places are unable to do this. And we were able to fix her aortic aneurysm without opening her abdomen and without giving her a blood transfusion. And by the way, she was 83 years old. So I think, and she walked out of the hospital. The second challenging case that's on our website, again, is an open, Well, it's a beating heart off-pump coronary bypass surgery. So what this is, it's a minimally invasive type of cardiac surgery where you don't have to stop the heart, okay? You don't have to go on the bypass machine and circulate the blood through a machine because you keep the heart beating on its own. And we were able to do this coronary bypass without blood. And partially, we were able to do that because we didn't stop the heart and we didn't use the bypass machine. So this is another challenging case we did successfully. And then there's Tammy case, who's sitting right here. Tammy presented just around 40 years of age. She's young, and she has severe aortic valve disease. And she also had aortic root aneurysm. So she had a dilation of the largest blood vessel in her body, which is the aorta. And you can see, so this is before surgery, you see the ballooning out of her aorta, and then inside there, her aortic valve was not competent. It was leaking, so the blood was going backwards through the valve. And when Tammy presented, well, before she came to us, she went to another major academic center in the Midwest, and they said, we can't help you. Without a blood transfusion, we can't do your surgery. And it happens to be one of the top four hospitals in the country that turned her down. And so we took her to Duke Cameron, who's the chief of cardiac surgery at Hopkins, and we sat down with an hour. Me, Tammy, and her parents sat down for an hour, and he said, I think we can do this. It's a high-risk surgery, but we can replace your aortic valve and your aortic root, and if we give you EPO and iron to pump up your hemoglobin before the surgery, then we can get you through this. And that's what we did. This is her surgery, or a surgery like it, actually, on the right. It's a very, very complicated procedure, lots of equipment, lots of machines. We use the Cell Saver, which I'll talk about in a minute. We have a paper that just came out last month called Risk-Adjusted Clinical Outcomes in Patients Enrolled in a Bloodless Program. We basically show that our patients without blood transfusion do better than patients who accept blood transfusion. So in all the outcomes we looked at, which I show here, for example, heart attack, no difference, okay, between the bloodless in the blue and the blood patients in the red. No difference for heart attack, no difference for respiratory complications, no difference for renal failure. When you looked at infection, the difference was there. It wasn't quite significant with less infection in the bloodless patients. When we looked at mortality, that's death in the hospital, we had a lower mortality in the bloodless patients shown here, less than 1% compared to the other patients who took blood. Not only that, but the cost of care was less. So when we looked at direct costs and total costs, of taking care of bloodless patients, there was about a 14% less cost to care for our bloodless patients compared to the other patients. Last thing I want to say before I introduce our next speaker is I want to talk about the Cell Saver. So the Cell Saver was invented in 1978. It's a machine that we use to recycle the blood that you lose. So you lose the blood, we collect the blood during surgery, we clean the blood, and give it back to you. So not all Jehovah's Witnesses accept the Cell Saver, but in my experience, about 95% of them do. It's a personal choice, as you know. And we have had the Cell Saver save people's lives during surgery. And I'm going to tell you how it works, and a paper that we had on the Cell Saver that came out last month. So it's basically recycling blood, and we compare the quality of the recycled blood to the stuff that comes from the blood bank. So the recycled blood is fresh, right? It's only been out of the patient for maybe half an hour, okay? But the blood bank blood has been sitting in the blood bank for up to 6 weeks, okay? So we have this paper where we compared the quality of the fresh recycled blood compared to the blood bank blood had been sitting in the blood bank for up to 6 weeks. And we found that the Cell Saver blood was higher quality, okay? The red blood cells were fresher, they had a better membrane function. And when we published the paper, it got written up in the Washington Post, saying we recycle a lot of things, paper, plastic, metal, and blood. And no one ever thinks about recycling blood, but it's really the best blood we can get. The New York Times also picked up on our paper and talked about reusing a patient's own blood, and then they interviewed me and talked about our study, telling how we demonstrated that Cell Saver blood was better. I'm going to end with this, then I'm going to introduce Dr. Han, who's our urology visiting professor today. This is a direct quote from a Hopkins surgeon, and this is from one of our orthopedic surgeons. He sent this email to us last week. It said, "Thanks to you and your team. Your team is amazing. I wish I had you for all my patients. Mr. Patient X is still weak, but stronger each day, and I expect a full recovery of his strength." And Dr. Shuba is the orthopedic surgeon, and he was so grateful that we were there to follow his patient through surgery to help him avoid the need for transfusion and still have a good outcome. So this is how our surgeons feel about us. And with that, I'm going to introduce Misop Han, and I'll get your slides up for you.